Welcome everybody, buonasera a tutti. This evening we have the book presentation of the memoir of Andrea Viterbi, a reflection of an educator, researcher, and entrepreneur. It's a pleasure and an honor for us to have Andrea Viterbi here at the Institute. This evening organized by the Institute together with Centro Primo Levi, and in a few moments I leave the floor to Alessandro Cassini. Before, I only want to present you Andrea Viterbi. Was born in Bergamo and fled to the United States with his family following the promulgation of the racial laws. He developed the Viterbi algorithm as a way to decode encoded data, which enabled cellular technology and has application in many different fields. Andrea Viterbi was a graduate of MIT, and he has been a professor at the School of Engineering and Applied Science at UCLA and UC San Diego, and is now professor emeritus. Among many awards he received is this National Medal of Science from the President of the United States. We will have a conversation between Andrea Viterbi and Maria Teresa Cometto, is a journalist, an award-winning author based in New York, author also of a book, Tech in the City, about new technology in New York City. Since 2000, she has been covering business and high tech for Corriere della Sera, the leading Italian daily newspaper, and other important periodicals. And then I leave the floor to Alessandro Cassini of Centro Primo Levi, and thank him. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
No.
Many thanks to Giorgio Van Straten and the Italian Cultural Institute for hosting this event. It is truly a thrill and an honor to present Andrea Viterbi's book here tonight, and thank you all for coming. Andrea Viterbi and his late wife, Erna Finci Viterbi, have been over the years great friends, supporters, and interlocutors for Centro Primo Levi in all of our activities. This book traces a life trajectory and extraordinary career that are both exemplary and inspiring. It is a story of adversities met and overcome, about hard work and its rewards, about focused creativity and uncommon intelligence. It is about achievement, persistency, luck, and love. And of course, it is a story about building bridges between different worlds. You will soon hear details of Viterbi's remarkable achievements in science and technology. I want to add that for me, this book is also, and perhaps mostly, about transitions. Transition between the racist intolerance of Mussolini's Italy, and the vast opportunities of this new country, which of course had its own trappings of its own. The transition between a career of a brilliant professor of communication theory and the laboratories of aerospace research and development. The transition between pure and applied science, between entrepreneurship and philanthropy. Without taking any more time, it is my pleasure to introduce Andrew Viterbi.
Let's see how this works. Can you all hear me all right?
Not so much.
In the back of the room also? Okay. Thank you very much, Alessandro. Alessandro Cassin is my friend and my consigliere. He, when I first showed him my little memoir that I had written pretty much for my family, especially my grandchildren, I call it an ethical will, he commented on how my career had been so varied and that it's hard to decide what I am. Well, he's right. Of course, I would say that the title recognizes that, educator, researcher, entrepreneur. Well, educator and researcher really means an academic. That's pretty common. More and more academics are becoming entrepreneurs. In fact, there are whole institutions like Cornell Tech here, which is turning academics into entrepreneurs. But I believe that I also have a split ethnicity, which is much more complicated. That of Italian-born, American, dedicated American, and Jew. So you take the three, Italian, American, Jewish, it's very hard to, for most people, to appreciate what all that means. Any two makes sense, Italian-American or American-Jew, for example, or even Jewish-Italian. But all three, it's complicated. Well, it's complicated because, really, I had hardly any experience in Italy. I came to the United States, or I was brought by my parents, when I was 4 years old. Fortunate for me, I lived with them, of course, for the next 22 years, and, no, actually, the next 16 years, or 18 years, I started before, but I lived the first 22 years of my life with my parents, and they instilled in me a respect and in some cases, love for Italy, and also, more important, I think, was the language and the culture. Now, of course, all of my education, all of my upbringing, and all of my attention has been to things American. So, with that, I'm also have an identity, a strong identity as a Jew. And this is partly a consequence of what my parents went through and what the world was like in 1935 when I was born through 1938 and then coming to the United States. And the war, which of course changed everything. But what brought me back to my Italian roots, more than my birth or my heritage, and the heritage goes back, we traced it back to the 1700s in two ghettos, Mantova and the Casale Monferrato. And of course, a century, that was for two centuries, and then one century after the Risorgimento, where the condition and the position of Italian Jews was part of the Risorgimento and resurrected and honored until the bad times of fascism. With all this, that's how I begin the book. And then I go on into my American story. I think I've spoken enough. Maria Teresa, it's up to you now.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I'm so excited and so honored to be here with Dr. Viterbi, and I thank you very much l'Istituto di Cultura Italiano and the director Giorgio Van Straten and Centro Primo Levi for letting me do this conversation. Because I cover technology and business, of course I know very well what Dr. Viterbi did and how important is his work for the whole digital revolution that has changed our everyday life. But let's start with the very beginning. You mentioned you were born in Italy and you had to leave when you were only 4 years old because of the racial laws. Your parents were among the very first Italian Jews to decide to leave Italy. Why do you think so? Why were they so far-seeing?
Well, certainly there was a what my father called a kick, a healthy kick, and when he lost his position and was unable to even practice medicine. Beyond that, I think that their urgency was due because most Italian Jews remained and made the best of it until 1943. But they felt that I had no opportunities under the circumstances. I couldn't even go to school. So I think they did it for me, and it was a great gift.
Yes, sure. So you left Europe in 39, August 15, from France, and in 12 days you arrived to the New York City harbor. So you were only 4 years old, but can you remember anything of those days and of your staying in New York City?
Yes. Some very minor things. Being invited by a cousin who was much older than I, to go to Radio City Music Hall to see the Rockettes. And it wasn't so much the Rockettes at 5 years of age. I couldn't appreciate that so much, but I did appreciate the staging. They had what seemed to me an entire battleship came on stage, and that I can remember well. I also remember once my struggle to learn English, even though it all happened in a very short time. I think within a year I was fluent. But in the first months, I had a little bit of trouble. I had a teacher who wasn't very nice and put me behind in the corner because I couldn't understand what she wanted me to do. And that's how the friendship of my mother and the grandmother of, the mother and grandmother of one of the audience here came forth and said, I'll take care of that teacher. And they remained friends, and our families remained friends through at least three generations. But the other thing was one time I came out of school. I was in kindergarten, and my mother wasn't there. That's because my aunt had just arrived, and she had gone to pick her up, and she came late, and I was desolate. And so I turned, I've forgotten exactly who I turned to, but eventually a policeman, an Irish policeman who couldn't understand a word I said, he decided he'd take me to somebody who would understand me, the local fruit and vegetable vendor, who said, well, your mother didn't come to get you. Well, you'll have to wait. That's right, she came eventually.
How did it end?
It ended that she came, and then I learned English.
In the book, you also remember the Statue of Atlas, which became something very meaningful to you. Yes. In which way?
Well,
Atlas
again,
at the Rockefeller Center, you know the...
Again, a little five-year-old. And looks up and is holding the world. I decided much, much later that maybe that was an introduction. That was what I would be expected to do.
Okay, in 41, your family moved to Boston, where your father could practice medicine. And after a few months, the Japan attacked America. So your status changed and you became enemy aliens. How did you feel?
Well, it had no impact at all, except we had to go to the FBI offices in the old Boston Custom House, which at the time was the biggest building in Boston, and be fingerprinted. And to which I turned to my mother and said, why are we enemies? We're enemies over there, now we're enemies over here. Does that make any sense? And what was it, about 20 months later, with the armistice, that condition was removed, and my father, they had confiscated all firearms, naturally, shortwave radios and cameras, still photographic cameras, from the aliens. And as I said, about 20 months later, my father got a postcard saying, come to the FBI office and you can recover your goods. And all he had was a camera, because he never had a firearm, and he did not have a shortwave radio. But he went into the office, they gave it to him, and he was ecstatic. It was a camera, of course, he had bought to photograph me when I was born 4 years earlier. And he said, only in America can you get back things that are confiscated. So
he had a positive attitude, notwithstanding.
He went from being an Italian patriot to an American patriot.
So how was your life as a Jewish Italian boy immigrant in Boston, in America?
Well, the circle of friends of my parents was very small, and it was mostly the Italian Jews. There were 2,000 or so in Italy, as was well recorded by the book Mi Ricordo di Ponte Corboli. In Boston there were maybe 6 or 7 families, and there were very small, very few children, but they were my playmates. Judaism, we were very secular then, and I got a couple of years of Jewish education, but not very much. So that when a time came for my bar mitzvah, which was in 1948, we went back to Italy for it, because that's where most of the family was. And I got a crash course in Torino by a young man who, and the rabbis were willing to let me go ahead with the bar mitzvah ceremony in spite of my ignorance, largely because my uncle had been the principal of the Jewish liceo, high school, when during the racial laws, Jewish children could no longer go to the public schools. So he had clout, and he got me to the bar mitzvah, and I met for the first time his son-in-law, who was none other than Primo Levi. And I remember the conversations between my father and Primo Levi. He was very taken. At a time when Primo was well known in the family, but not in the rest of the society.
Did you keep in touch with Primo Levi during your life? What was your relationship?
Until the end of his life, yes. Often, whenever we went to Turin, we would visit the family and visited the ladies. But also, I hosted him at my house when he came on his only American lecture tour. And I have the pleasure and the honor to escort him to give a lecture in Claremont, California, which was dear to my home.
Yeah, in the book, talking again about your teenager years, you write that you felt as an outsider, and you were even bullied at school.
Well, those are two separate issues. The outsider was simply because I went to a school in the Back Bay, one of the nicer neighborhoods of Boston, where almost all the children were either WASP or Roman Catholic. The Roman Catholics were mostly Irish there. The Italians were further over in a different region. They were, by the way, the Italian Americans were the clientele of my father. He would not have been able to set up a practice if it hadn't been for that. We were grateful for our living for some years. I recount a very minor episode that, in spite of the fact that there is a separation between religion and the state and the church are separated by our constitution, nevertheless, so that no religious education could be carried out, the Boston Public Schools had come to a compromise, and so once a week they would send the Irish Catholic children would go to Santa Cecilia, St. Cecilia, a church for an hour or two of religious training, and the Protestants or the WASPs, White Anglo-Saxons, would go to the Old South Church in Copley Square for their religious education. So I was left all alone. And the teachers didn't know what to do with me. One time I heard two teachers talking and said, well, we've only got one of them this year. So obviously it was an outsider. Bullying is a completely separate issue. It's something that has been going on not only in the United States, everywhere among children. It's become much more of an issue today, but it was traditional, I might say. And I was a very timid, shy boy, immigrant, and maybe with my nature also. And so I was obviously a target for the bullies, but nothing serious. I never, other than it doesn't make you feel good.
Then, talking about your education, you felt at home at the MIT. You studied electrical engineering there, and then you studied digital communication at the University of Southern California. So it was a very new field. What attracted you to this new field? Why did you choose it?
Well, first of all, electrical engineering is a very broad field, a very broad area. The computer, what we call computer science, is simply a branch of electrical engineering. And electrical engineers have now gotten into all sorts of areas. They range from applied mathematics, sometimes pure mathematics. Cryptography, for example, is very much of a subfield today of electrical engineering and computer science. And by the way, at MIT, they never separated the two. It's one of the few universities that kept it combined. It was always computer science came out of electrical engineering. Now, it has spread to everything today is digital. All the knowledge that you get on Google and Facebook and whatever else is digital. And so, It has spread, particularly today, to biology and to the study of genomics and genetics. And that time, it was much narrower, of course. It had started out with electric power. But by the time I Dr. College, electronics was just starting, and we were going from these large and heavy and power-hungry devices called vacuum tubes that if you're less than 45 years old, you've never heard of, and into the transistor era, where everything was smaller, but not so dramatically so in the 50s. It wasn't until the 60s, the mid-60s, that we started to integrate transistors, have multiple transistors, and today we have 1 billion transistors on a chip. And this, of course, is the well-known Moore's law that predicted that density and would double, that power would be cut in half, and that speeds would increase proportionally. And of course, we've come 1 billion-fold since then, and this is an old story. So I got in right at the beginning, and I was very fortunate. As for digital communication, already when I was an undergraduate, I was a cooperative student, which meant that I would spend time some of the semesters actually at a company, and happened to be at Raytheon, which then was a small company in Waltham, now it's enormous. And that's where I first became familiar with a transistor and with computers. And then I went, after getting my master's degree at MIT, I went to work. My first job was at JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, which is managed by Caltech, but actually at the time was working just on defense contracts. Shortly after I started there, the Russians conveniently launched Sputnik, and we converted over from defense to space. And that's where I really got interested in digital communication. And at the same time, I was working on studying for my PhD. I did my dissertation on digital communications, which was what I was working on at JPL. So that was a good start, and then I continued in it for the rest of my career.
Yeah, so you were lucky to be there when the Sputnik moment happened, and the race to the space was one of the factors for your research. You became famous for the algorithm that is named after you. What inspired you to elaborate?
Well, several things. By the time I spent 6 years at JPL, and then I had my PhD by then, and I was offered a position teaching at UCLA. But I continued consulting at JPL, and space communication was still very much a topic of interest. I was teaching a course in information theory, which is a branch of applied mathematics that deals with the efficient transmission and processing of information. In teaching a course, which had significant applications to many areas, including space communication, I came up with a theorem, actually, dealing with a class of codes. They're often called error-correcting codes, but they're really error-avoiding codes, ways of protecting the transmission of digital information from interference of all sorts. Random noise, as well as interference from other users of that spectrum. So the class of codes is called convolutional codes, have been actually proposed and discovered at MIT some years earlier. And they were beginning to be applied, but I wanted to prove that they were more useful and more practical than other methods. In so doing, I had to prove an asymptotic relation, but I'm not going to try and explain that. But there was a missing step that I needed, and the missing step was a formula, a prescription, really, a recipe for practical decoding, which meant extracting information from this coded sequence. And in finding that missing step, that's where the algorithm came in. And I wrote a paper entitled Error Bounds and a Asymptotically Optimum Non-Sequential Algorithm, which doesn't mean anything to us. But because I never called it my algorithm, but then people started using it and they called it Martin Viterbi algorithm. And so that I got more glory out of it than I deserved.
Well, it's easier to call it the Viterbi algorithm. Talking about algorithms, today some critics talk about algorithms like evil. There is even a book called Weapons of Math Destructions, because there is a question about algorithm making decisions instead of humans, and all the way that this can go wrong. Should we be worried about algorithms?
Well, algorithms go back to at least the Middle Ages. I think it comes from an Arabic word. That's because in the early years of the second millennium, the mathematics, the greatest mathematicians were Arabs. So algorithms have been around forever. They're nothing more than prescriptions, formulas, telling you specifically what to do. When it comes to digital matters, of course, now it is an algorithm is a digital program. And so anything you do with that pad or in controlling robots, etc., it's all algorithms. In cryptography, there are algorithms for creating secrecy and trying to extract useful information from things that have been encrypted. So, algorithms are everywhere, and they can be damaging, but for the most part, they're very, very useful.
Of course. At a certain point, you left the academy and you decided to found your own startup. First in 68, Linkabit, and then in 85, Qualcomm, which is one of the largest companies in the world, and they make semiconductors and equipment for telecommunications. What made you change from academy to business?
Well, it was not a dramatic change. It was a natural progression, because a couple of years after I wrote that paper that I mentioned, the algorithm, we discovered at JPL that there could be relatively simple practical application. In other words, my original theory was purely theoretical. It was really dealt with things that would have taken a very large amount of equipment. In 68, we discovered that there could be an application which would reduce the amount of power required, actually the signal-to-noise ratio, to extract information. You realize that in space, you're transmitting, even from a satellite around the Earth, you're transmitting over thousands of miles. And of course, if you go to the moon, it's about 25,000 miles. So in transmitting a signal over that long range, it diffuses and you get a very, very weak signal, and meanwhile you have the background noise. So we found that we could actually double the range which really meant operate in a signal that was one quarter as smaller, four times smaller, by using these coding and decoding techniques, the algorithm. So it became of considerable interest to NASA and to the Department of Defense because they were doing a lot of satellite communication. And so we were encouraged, actually, to start something. It was three professors. And one dropped out after a while and got too interested in the internet. But the other two, my colleague Erwin Jacobs and I, proceeded and built up our first company, Linkabit, then sold it to a company in Boston. And after spending five more years there, we started a second company, Qualcomm, which again came along at the right time that cellular, well, first we did it, we developed a system for communicating via satellite to commercial trucks, particularly those that went long distance, coast to coast. And that was a success. And after that, based on that, we recognized the opportunity of using much of the same technology in cellular telephony. And after a long struggle, both within the United States, some of the original components of AT&T were very, very negative on it, but we were supported by other components that are now Verizon, and we were able to develop a market in the United States and in certain parts of Asia, Korea, and then later Japan. And Europe was the last to come on. They wanted to do their own thing, and it took us about 15 years to convince them. And now they're all using pretty much the same technology, much of which was developed at Qualcomm. So Qualcomm in the what's called 3G and 4G has the largest market share of chips, not of phones, but of the
chips and our phones,
the integrated circuits that make it now happen.
Did you feel more excited as a professor in the academy or as an entrepreneur?
A little of both. It depended on what time, when, and under what circumstances. I was very excited when I was doing research, because cracking the puzzle is quite a strong feeling of success. And in industry, yes, when your product is or your technology is adopted, you feel good. You also feel bad competitors denigrate your product, which happened a lot in the early days. I talk a little bit about it in the book.
Yeah, I can imagine. Then in 2000, you changed again, and you decided to leave Qualcomm, and you became an investor. And it was a very tough time, because it was just before the burst of the internet bubble, 2000, and the crash of NASDAQ. So how did you survive the crash?
It's no problem of surviving. No, it was, I consider myself an amateur venture capitalist. And I invested in about 40 companies, of which a few, and I mentioned them in the book, have been good successes, and some have failed completely, which is the nature of venture capital. I never was at risk. I'm relatively conservative in any case, not politically, but financially. And actually, it wasn't just a matter of investing. The companies that I was most interested and most involved with. I was also a technical advisor, and sometimes I would be both a board member and a technical advisor. And so one of my best was a company that had been a spin-off of Bell Labs of AT&T and came up with the principles of what would be demonstrated the fourth generation, so-called 4G telephony, which has now been absorbed, was actually acquired by Qualcomm, of all things. So yeah, I'm still having fun doing that sort of thing, less and less, but because I have other interests, one of them is philanthropy and another is, I'm still involved in my profession. I give lectures, I attend committee meetings and so forth in various universities.
Yeah. In your book, you mention another book, The Triple Package, by the former Tiger Mom, Amy Chua, who is Chinese, and her husband, who is Jewish. And according to that book, there are three traits that lead to success. First is insecurity, second is exceptionalism, and third is deferred gratification. And you identify with this recipe
all three
for success.
I think probably the most important is the deferred gratification.
Can you talk about all the three traits?
Well, sure. What was the first again?
Insecurity.
Insecurity, if you're an immigrant child and you are struggling to become part of this great nation, you have to feel insecure. And this is true of all immigrants, of all ages, I would add. So that gave me the impetus in order to succeed. And my parents inculcated that to me from birth, that an education is the route to success. And the second, the exceptionalism, well, that's that was the most controversial of Amy Chua's three tenets, being because, it involves ethnicity. It's not that that I do take pride in both my Jewish and my Italian origins, but in any case, I can point to a lot of Nobel Prizes and very successful scientists and entrepreneurs. So that was number two, and number three is deferred gratification. Well, if you study hard, you don't have much time for other things, but after a while, you enjoy what you study. So it all works out very well. So I think she was right, and I felt like I would have liked to have written that book.
Talking about your identity. In the book, you write that initially you rejected your Italian identity, also because nobody from Italy ever apologized for what happened to your family.
Okay, that's my very personal opinion. And more important is the fact that I was a very small child, but I was very much aware of what went on around me. Of course, just listening to my parents as an only child, I was the only person that was really completely involved. I felt a very negative feelings. Also, it was a very bad time in America. Anti-Semitism was ferocious of all peoples, but Italian Americans were partly because they had been great followers of the Duce for good reasons. They had been discriminated against, as the Jews were, but the Italians equally and sometimes even worse, partly because they came with very little education. They came from the misery of unemployment, and also many of the Sicilians had come as a result of the earthquake, the Terremoto di Messina, vero? And they were somewhat subjugated. When the Duce, when fascism came along, Italy was suddenly a great power, and they took great pride in it. So it was quite a transition when they then found themselves that Italy was now an enemy. So I went through all that phase, and so I didn't have too much sympathy, other than after the war, fascism had been completely subjugated, at least at that time, and it was a new government and a new Italy. However, where I really became reconciled to my Italian heritage and background was from my wife, because she was not Italian. She was born in Sarajevo, but a Jewish family was at great peril because of the Nazis, who were now taking Jews into concentration camps, and that was the Holocaust. And they found protection in Italy. They found protection by going to the Dalmatian coast, to Montenegro first, and then Rijeka, where they were sort of under the protection of the Italian army, which never turned Jews over to the German, the SS. And eventually they were confinati, which is not exactly imprisoned, but limited to a small town near Parma, Gramignazzo di Sissa, and there they were protected by the local people, and particularly after 43. So after I heard all that, changed my mind.
You mentioned that your last part of your last career, let's say, is in philanthropy. Can you explain in favor of which causes?
Well, first and foremost, education. And I feel that, particularly for this nation, it's true of all nations, but I'm most interested in the future of my grandchildren in this country. And the nation is highly dependent on its leadership in science and technology, because we don't have all that many natural resources. Those that we have, we use internally. If we're going to be successful in the world, and what is it that we export? We export expertise and the products of our ingenuity, our science and our technology. And so I have supported various chairs in some of the major universities in this country, and to some degree, and also in Israel. And so that's one area. And then, of course, health research in the health sciences and health services, and that is equally important, and it's a great area of research. And I've even supported the Lyceum, the Licei, the high schools, the one I went to in Boston Latin School, and some of the high schools that my grandchildren attended. So that and many other things, but I've said enough.
You supported also Technion, which is called the MIT of Israel. And the Technion has a partnership with Cornell University here in New York City to build a new campus on Roosevelt Island. Probably you have seen that. How important it will be that new campus for New York City and for innovation here?
Well, they've started well. They've actually gotten their first graduating class, and I think they've all been employed. It's a master's degree in in technology and entrepreneurship. And I think it was a very good move. It's very young. It's not going to take on Columbia or NYU, not for
Stanford.
Stanford. These are all major, well-established universities. And yes, Silicon Valley has been greatly aided or engendered by Stanford. But I wouldn't exaggerate. There's a lot of very good universities in this country. MIT has its own now, what do they call it? They call it Silicon Avenue or Silicon Beach. And so it is throughout the nation. There's Austin, Texas. There's San Diego, California. These are all centers of technology, which have clusters around, in all cases, around a very good university.
I will stop here with my questions for the time being and open the to you. I'm sure you have a lot of questions and curiosity. So who wants to be the first one? Okay.
I'm a doctor in the 50s and 60s, there was clear anti-Semitism in universities.
Particularly the medical schools. They were the last to integrate, yes.
What was any of that at MIT? Were there other Jewish academics there? And what was the situation?
Well, first of all, in the student body, I can tell you about a third of the student body at that time was Jewish. The faculty, much has been written about all Eastern universities at that time. There were several Jewish professors, and I was a student after the Second World War, and things really turned around with the Manhattan Project, with the Radiation Laboratory, and many other achievements where a great many Jewish scientists and engineers were involved. I never felt it. I heard stories that back in the 20s, it was very rare. And even Feynman, who had been a student there, in one of his, there's a very good biography of Richard Feynman, Nobel laureate, one of the greatest physicists of the 20th century. It's called Genius. And in it, talks about the letter that the chairman of the physics department at MIT wrote to Princeton saying what a brilliant student they had. And he said, of course, he's one of those, but he's not like the rest of them. Talk about outsiders. So sure, there was anti-Semitism. There was anti-Semitism everywhere. But it was very mild by then, and it pretty much disappeared. And I gather in medical schools, equal.
Then I wanted to ask you one thing. I think when we spoke, you mentioned you were a student of Robert Fano, who recently died.
Yes.
I would like to know how he influenced you. He was another giant of technology.
Yes. Yes. This is Ms. Pontecorboli, who wrote the book, Mi Ricordo. Bob Fano, Roberto Mario Fano, but everybody called him Bob. He came to America when he was only 18, I believe, but he cultivated his Italian accent. He was a great teacher. I took a course in my third year, my junior year, from him. And when I wrote my master's thesis, I asked his advice. He had been an acquaintance of the family, being Italian-Jewish. Not only that, but his father was born in the same city as my father, Mantova. And so the there was a connection there. His father was a very famous mathematician, Gino Fanu, was at the University of Turin, and there were several Jewish mathematicians, Italian Jewish mathematicians at Turin. Fubini was the other one. Yes, he advised me, and he was also a, he had a very varied career. He started in radar, electromagnetic transmission and reflection off of objects. Then he evolved into information theory, and that's where I learned the most from him. And finally, he became the father of the internet that people don't know. But he established the computer laboratory at MIT that was actually one of the very first to interconnect computers. I actually saw a demonstration he put on at a conference in Los Angeles in 1964, which is about 4 or 5 years before the start of the so-called ARPANET, which was the origin or the progenitor of the internet. So he did many things, but what I learned most was information theory. He wrote the first important monograph on the subject, and I used that in teaching when I first started teaching at UCLA, and in fact, much of what I learned that applied to the algorithm that originally came from him. So yes, I was a great fan of Bob Plano, who just passed away at age 96.
I'm curious to know whether or not you had any arts education in addition to all the mathematics you studied, and whether or not you think that's an important component of mathematical, scientific, academic life.
Well, let me answer it in a different way. I believe in things other than the natural sciences. As a matter of fact, I did have a very good humanities education because I studied, my high school was the Boston Latin School. I studied Latin for 5 years and two other languages, German and French. So I believe in the humanities. I was never good at art. I don't remember, I guess in elementary, maybe even in junior high, I had art classes, but I was so bad at it that I never continued. However, I can tell you that today, the Boston Latin School, which is one of, the other day I was at the Bronx High School of Science, which is one of the preeminent public schools here. And similarly, in Boston, it's the Latin School, which also teaches science and mathematics, by the way, just as the Bronx High School of Science teaches humanities and arts. But today they have a very strong, Boston Latin has a very strong music program, and I don't know about the graphic arts, but I'm sure they also have courses there. But I was deprived, self-deprived, I'll have to admit.
In fact, many famous mathematicians were also musicians, right?
Yes, exactly.
Music and algorithms apparently go well together. More questions?
Were you ever concerned in the early days of in business of being hacked, or your secrets being stolen? Was that an issue, a big issue at that time?
I would say, first of all, hacking and the power of hacking required a well-established internet, which really only happened in this century. So in most of my career, that was not a problem. What we did were concerned with was the leaking of uh, private knowledge, knowledge that, you know, losing people, people being recruited away who had, who were taking trade secrets, so to speak, away with them. So yes, we were worried about the leakage of information, but not through the internet.
What do you believe will be the next great leap in communication for the internet? What do you see? You know, what do you see coming?
Well, there are a number of things happening now. It isn't a great leap. It's more of an evolution. But the Internet of Things is one of the buzzwords. And as a matter of fact, hacking is a big problem, because if you're going to connect controls, your temperature control, or worse still, your automobile, and control it at a distance, that is a big threat. So I don't know how far this Internet of Things will go, but what is certainly clear is that more and more bandwidth is becoming available. And it isn't just a matter of going to higher frequencies. It's also a matter of having more and more very small repeaters or base stations. So you'll be able, with the fifth generation of communication systems coming on, you'll be able to transmit very large amounts of information, relatively short distances, but then you'll have more and more small base stations. So there are many technologies that are evolving. What's the next big thing? I don't know. Would I have predicted 20 years ago the evolution of the internet today? No, I didn't. We were really building voice communication. We weren't building a knowledge base, I mean, that is not making available the knowledge of and the interconnectivity of all things and all people back then. And so, but I still feel that everything that I've seen has been evolutionary rather than a great big thing all at once.
Did you know Silvio Catania? Do you know his work at all? Silvio Catania. He's an Italian scientist. He worked in the telephone field in Italy and went to Cuba to bring the story of Medici to the Italians.
I'm sorry, I can't hear well enough.
I'm sorry. Did you know Silvio Catania, the late Silvio
Catania?
Catania. I don't, I'm sorry. Well, I think I've exhausted you all.
Shall we wrap it up, or shall we have a couple more questions? Earlier you defined yourself as an amateur venture capitalist. And in the book, you also recall that when you were young, you were a mild socialist.
I inherited that from my father.
Yeah. And also you say, socialism is indispensable in three areas: healthcare, basic research, and quality education, while capitalism incentivizes people to achieve to the best of their ability, sometimes forcefully by threatening starvation.
Starvation.
Starvation, exactly.
Well, that was a bit extreme, but I was thinking before there was the social safety net, before social security, before many good things attempt to at least protect our common people. But I don't know. I feel that cannot be done the human nature is not sufficiently altruistic to guarantee that. And I think that's one of the functions of government. But I think equally important, and maybe more so, is the fact that progress, long-term successes, the next really great thing, can only come through long-term research, which only a governmental entity can, will be, it isn't a matter of can, it's will be willing to support.
And at which point do you think America is right now in that direction?
Well, the fact is, unfortunately, that much of the basic research that has been done in this country has been for fear of the other, namely the Cold War. During the Cold War, the great fear was that we would all be attacked with nuclear weapons and we were defenseless. So the US government, mostly the Department of Defense, spent large sums. Much of it was wasted, but enough of it went to valuable research, and my field in particular, in electronics and digital communication, but in many, many fields, some of which were actually weapons, but a lot of it was did get into useful and even consumer products. And space was a big part of that. But space was really a derivative of our fear of the other, of not being the first and therefore being at risk if the Russians got to space first. Maybe that was exaggerated, but that's how it worked out. Well, ever since the end of the Cold War, we have retreated because those funds were no longer, they should have been turned into support for the National Science Foundation, for example. They did, to a great extent, be turned towards health sciences, the National Institute of Health, until recently. That, too, is now diminishing. So this has worked well for a long time. The Europeans have learned from it. There's science projects like the great the Halcyon nuclear facility where they're doing things that we decided they were too expensive for us.
Okay, I think we may thank.
Thank you so much, both of you, Maria Teresa Fumetto and Terry. And we'd like to invite everybody to have a drink outside. Copies of Terry's book will be available. And thank you so much for coming. And thank you for the time.